The point I want to make is that if you compute this, if you compute it and write it down, you will get this inequality. Okay. So let's compute it. See what is so what is the expression for g? So what is g of so g is like this. G is a function of zeta, and z is g of zeta, right? And what is g of zeta? G of zeta is just zeta plus z naught by 1 plus z naught bar zeta. This is the inverse of g. Okay, you can check that this is the inverse to this. All right, and if you now just differentiate, calculate the derivative using the quotient rule. So you will get differentiate with respect to zeta. You will get this is 1 plus z naught bar zeta whole squared 1 plus z naught bar zeta into I differentiate this with respect to zeta, I get 1 minus, I keep the numerator constant, I differentiate this with respect to zeta, I get z naught bar, and so what I get is I get 1 plus z naught bar zeta minus zeta z naught bar minus z naught bar, all right, divided by 1 plus z naught bar zeta the whole squared, and of course these two cancel out, so I get 1 minus z naught bar is mod z naught the whole squared by 1 plus z naught bar zeta the whole squared. So you know if you calculate mod g dash of 0, which is what we want, mod g dash of 0, you put zeta equal to 0, you will get 1 minus mod z naught squared. Okay, that's what you will get for mod g dash of 0, that's the expression, and then I'll have to calculate what h dash of w naught is. So what is h of w naught? H of w naught is this function. So what is h of w? H of w is neat, it is this expression. So h of w is just w minus w naught by 1 minus w naught bar w. So if you calculate the derivative again by the quotient rule, I'll get the following: denominator squared, denominator constant, derivative of the numerator with respect to w, it's going to be 1 minus numerator constant, derivative of the denominator with respect to w is going to give me minus w naught bar. Okay, and so if I expand it out, I'll get 1 minus w naught bar w minus, so I'll get plus w naught bar minus w naught bar divided by 1 minus w naught bar w the whole squared, and these two will cancel. I'll simply get 1 minus mod w naught the whole squared, because w naught bar is mod w naught the whole squared by 1 minus w naught bar w the whole squared. So mod h dash of 0 h dash of W naught and I get, that's right. I should get this 1 minus mod W naught squared. So you know now you plug in these two values in this equation, in this inequation, and what you will get is I'll get 1 by 1 minus mod W naught the whole squared. That is the value of the derivative, modulus of derivative of h at w naught, and then I write mod f dash of z naught as it is, and I have to plug in mod g dash of 0. Mod g dash of 0 is 1 minus mod z naught the whole squared. This is less than or equal to 1. So that gives me what I want. I get mod f dash of 0 is less than or equal to 1 minus, mind you, w naught is fz naught by 1 minus mod z naught the whole squared, okay. And that is the statement. That is the inequality of Pick's lemma, okay. So and what you should understand is that now the, of course this in when I do this calculation I have fixed I have simply taken z naught to be any point in the unit disk and I have taken w naught to be its image, okay. Z naught is an arbitrary point, so that that inequality holds for any z naught in delta, and therefore I can replace instead of z naught I can put z where z belongs to delta, and therefore I get the inequality of Pick's lemma, okay. Now so the only thing that I have to tell you is that you get equality if and only if f is a holomorphic automorphism of the unit disk, so and that too for a single z naught. If we get equality for a z naught, then if you get equality here, that means you are actually getting equality here, okay. And but then you know in Schwarz lemma both the differential version and the original version of Schwarz lemma you always get equality only if the automorphism is an automorphism, only if the analytic function is an automorphism, okay. So you get mod, so if I write that out, h circle f circle g derivative of 0 is equal to 1 implies h circle f circle g is an automorphism of delta fixing 0, fixing the origin, and this implies that because you know h and g are also automorphisms, okay, you will get that f which is just h inverse composition h circle f circle g composition g inverse okay is also an automorphism of course when I say automorphism holomorphic also a holomorphic automorphism of delta, okay. So you see the what is the both the usual version of Schwarz's lemma from the unit disk to the unit disk and the differential version, both are statements about inequalities, okay, both give you inequalities and they tell that you get an equality only in the case when the function that you are considering from the unit disk to the unit disk is an automorphism. You get equality only when it is an automorphism. If it is not an automorphism, by that if it is not an automorphism is supposed to be a self map, okay, map from a given set back to itself. So if you have an analytic function from the unit disk to the unit disk which is not an isomorphism, namely not an automorphism, then you will get only a strict inequality at every point in the Schwarz lemma statements, okay. And the Schwarz lemma itself says, both the differential form and the usual form of the Schwarz lemma says that if you get equality even at one point, okay, which is at one point is in the differential version, if you get equality of the derivative at the origin with 1, modulus of the derivative at the origin with 1, then the function has to be an automorphism, okay. So and also the earlier version, the usual version of the Schwarz lemma also says that whenever you get an equality for a point which is different from the origin, okay, then the analytic function has to be an automorphism. So that condition will tell you that this h circle f circle g, which is a function to which we applied the differential version of Schwarz lemma, that this will be an automorphism. But then you can get f from this function by pre-composing with h inverse on the left and post-composing with g inverse on the right, okay, and that's possible because h and g are of course Mobius transformations, they have inverses, and therefore so this is an isomorphism, this is an isomorphism, this central thing is an isomorphism, this is also an isomorphism, composition of isomorphisms is again an isomorphism, so you will get f as an isomorphism. So that proves Pick's lemma, okay. So Pick's lemma tells you that you will get equality here for a single z naught if and only if you get equality there for all z naught, for every z, okay, and that will happen if and only if the function f is an automorphism. So if you so in other words, if f is not an automorphism unit disk, then there will be strict inequality here. It will mod f dash z naught is strictly less than this quantity on the right side, okay. So this is Pick's lemma, and as you can see, it is just a generalization of the differential version of Schwarz lemma, because in this, if I put z naught equal to 0, I get the differential version of the Schwarz lemma, which says the modulus of the derivative at the origin cannot exceed it cannot exceed 1, okay. If I put z naught equal to 0 and assume that f takes 0 to 0, that is, if I put z naught equal to 0 and assume that f of z naught is also 0, then if you put that here, you will get mod f dash of 0 is less than or equal to 1. That is the differential version of Schwarz lemma. So Pick's lemma is just a generalization of the differential version of Schwarz's lemma, okay. But the point is that it is the key to the so called hyperbolic geometry on the unit disk, which is what we have to study, okay. See, so let me again remind you what we did earlier was that, you know, we are on our way to prove the Riemann mapping theorem, okay. And in the Riemann mapping theorem what we are supposed to do is we are supposed to start with a simply connected domain which is not the whole complex plane, and you are supposed to map it holomorphically isomorphically onto the unit disk. The first step that we achieved was to map it holomorphically isomorphically onto a subdomain of the unit disk. So this was possible because the domain was simply connected and it was not the entire complex plane, okay. So we reduced the mapping problem to a subdomain of a simply connected subdomain of the unit disk, okay, all right. So you have to, now we are reduced to proving that given any simply connected subdomain of the unit disk, you can map it conformally onto the unit disk, okay. So our problem is completely reduced to studying subdomains of the unit disk, and so in other words, you have to study the unit disk carefully. And how we are going to do it, or the way we are going to do it which will help us, is study hyperbolic geometry on the unit disk, and the hyperbolic geometry depends on so called hyperbolic metric. And the hyperbolic metric, the key to the hyperbolic metric is the Pick's lemma, so which is a nice generalization of Schwarz's lemma, okay, the differential form of Schwarz's lemma. So you know, that's how this enters into the discussion of the proof that we are looking at of the Riemann mapping theorem, all right. So now we go on to study hyperbolic geometry. So so let me do that. So this is hyperbolic geometry on the unit disk. Delta. So this is open unit disk centered at the origin, radius 1. So you know, so you see. So let's begin by recalling certain facts. You know, if you have so suppose this is a complex plane, and suppose you have an arc. Suppose you have a piecewise smooth arc or a contour, which is just image of the unit interval or any closed interval on the real line by a function gamma which is piecewise differentiable, okay, and which is continuous, okay, and such that the derivatives are also piecewise, the derivatives are also continuous, okay. So if you take a contour from this point, which is gamma of A starting point to gamma of B, this is my path gamma or contour, then you know how to get the length of gamma. Length of gamma, and I will stress it, I will say, I will put in bra, I will just prefix it by Euclidean, okay, because this is the length in the usual sense, arc length. You know what is the formula for the Euclidean length of gamma. All you have to do is you simply have to integrate over gamma mod dz. This will give you the length of gamma, alright. And what is that integral? I mean, it's this integral is, well, you can also substitute, you can, this is from, you know, t equal to a to t equal to b modulus of d gamma t, and that will be just integral from a to b mod gamma dash of t into mod dt, okay, and of course t is increasing, so you don't have to put this mod here. So this is the Euclidean length of a of an arc, okay. Now what we are going to do is we are going to take a special case. We are going to look at this arc, we are going to look at such arcs or contours inside the unit disk, okay. So you are going to have situation like this. You have this closed interval AB, finite closed interval on the real line, and you are going to have this path or contour gamma, and see, the point is that this gamma lands inside the unit disk. So you know it is something like this. So this is the unit disk delta, and this is the complex plane again, alright. And now I am going to, again this is gamma of A, this is gamma of B, and this is my path gamma. And what I am going to do, I am going to do something new. Instead of defining the Euclidean length of gamma, which you know is this, you integrate mod dz over gamma, I am going to define the hyperbolic length of gamma, okay. That is only in the special case when the path is a path in the unit disk, okay. So here is the definition: hyperbolic length of gamma is, you see what you do, it is also an integral over gamma, okay. See, if I put integral over gamma and put mod dz, I will get the Euclidean length, okay. If I put integral over gamma and if I integrate mod dz, I will get the Euclidean length. But what I will do is, I will integrate mod, I will integrate 1 by 1 minus mod z the whole square into d mod dz. So I am adding this factor 1 by 1 minus mod z the whole square, which is the hyperbolic factor, okay. So this is called the hyperbolic length of gamma, okay. Now what is so special about this expression? The special thing about this expression is, you see, if I now take f to be an automorphism, holomorphic automorphism of the unit disk, that is, it is a map from the unit disk to the unit disk, which is holomorphic, injective, bijective, holomorphic, so its inverse is also holomorphic, so it is a holomorphic automorphism unit disk to unit disk, and then, you know, so what will happen is this, you know, this f will map. So this is my so this is the map w equal to fz, okay, and so this is the z plane, and here I have the w plane, alright. And what is going to happen is that because f is an automorphism, 1 to 1 onto inverse is also holomorphic, what is going to happen is that the image of this path is also going to be a simple path. It's also going to be a path inside the unit disk. So what I'm going to get is, I'm going to get another path like this. Starting point will be f of gamma of a, and the ending point will be f of gamma of b, and I'll get this path which is gamma followed by f. Okay, so it's this: you first apply gamma, then you apply f, then you get a path from a, from this closed interval a b into the unit disk. And what is that path? That is, that path is just gamma circle f. Yeah, it should be f composition gamma, f circle gamma, that's right, it should be f circle gamma, right. So I get this, so the path gamma is mapped by f isomorphically onto the path f circle gamma. Now you see the beautiful thing. You calculate the hyperbolic length of f circle gamma. Okay, what is the hyperbolic length of f circle gamma? Well, it is by definition integral over f circle gamma of mod dw by 1 minus mod w the whole square. This is the definition of hyperbolic length, where I am using the fact that my variable here is w and the variable here is z, so I am using the correct variable, alright. But you see, watch carefully, what is so now comes the you know, importance of Pick's lemma. Okay, now comes the importance of Pick's lemma. You see, what does Pick's lemma say? See, by Pick's lemma, what you will get is mod f dash of z is less than or is equal to 1 minus mod fz the whole squared by 1 minus mod z the whole squared for all z in the unit disk. You get this, you get equality in Pick's lemma, because f is an automorphism of the unit disk. Pick's lemma says that you get the inequality of Pick's lemma will become an inequality if the map is an, if and only if the map f is a automorphism. Okay, you get this. But then you see in this integral, you know, I can make change of variable by putting w equal to fz. If I make a change of variable, then this integral is the same as integral over gamma, okay, mod dfz by 1 minus mod fz the whole squared. Okay, but what is this? This is integral over gamma, dfz is f dash of z dz, so I will get mod f dash of z mod dz by 1 minus mod fz the whole squared. This is what I get. Okay, if I make a simplification, if I make change of variable from w to z using w equal to fz, I will get this. But what is this equal to by Pick's lemma? Mod f dash of z by 1 minus fz the whole squared is simply 1 by 1 minus mod z the whole squared. Therefore, what you get is, this is the same as this, these two are equal. These two are, this expression is the same as this expression because of Pick's lemma, because of the equality in Pick's lemma, which comes because f is an automorphism of the unit disk. Alright. So what is the moral of the story? The moral of the story is the following. The moral of the story is, if you define the hyperbolic length of an arc or contour in the unit disk, the hyperbolic length will not change if you apply an automorphism of the unit disk. You, whether you take the hyperbolic length of gamma or whether you take the hyperbolic length of its image under an automorphism of the unit disk, you will continue to get the same length, the same hyperbolic length. Therefore, we express this by saying that Pick's lemma, the equality in Pick's lemma actually asserts that for the automorphisms of the unit disk preserve the hyperbolic length. the equality in Pick's lemma assert that, you know, automorphisms in unit disk preserve the hyperbolic length, okay. So let me write that down. The automorphisms, the holomorphic automorphisms of delta preserve the hyperbolic length. An arc. So this is the this is a geometric statement concerning the equality in Pick's lemma, okay, and that is the importance of this expression. Instead of just integrating over mod dz, which will give you the Euclidean length, you integrate over mod dz by 1 minus mod z the whole square. That's the that gives you the hyperbolic length, right? Now, you know, the hyperbolic length is, I mean, the unit disk is anyway, as far as Euclidean space is concerned, or the that is the plane is concerned, the unit disk is bounded, and you know, if you take the ordinary length between any two points is going to be finite. Of course, it cannot exceed 2, which is the diameter of the unit disk. Right, if you take a straight line segment, the length is less than 2, okay, but what about hyperbolic distance? So you know, you can, we can, it's rather curious, we can make a computation. You know, if you take the unit disk and you know, take a point 0, take the point z, okay, take this straight line joining 0 and z, okay, and then try to calculate what this length is, what is the Euclidean length. Euclidean length, so you know, to calculate the Euclidean length, first of all I need a parameterization. I must think of this as a path. So you know, what I do is I just map 0 comma, so if z, suppose I call this point as z naught, and z naught is r naught into e power I theta naught, okay, where r naught is this length, which is actually the Euclidean length. And theta naught is this angle, so this angle is theta naught, and this length is r naught from here to here, okay. Then you know how to parameterize this path. So this path can be parameterized as 0 comma r naught map to, you just map 0 comma r naught to t, to the unit disk by simply sending t to t e power I theta naught, okay. When you put t equal to 0, you will get the origin. When you put t equal to r naught, you will get z naught, and you will get this straight line segment joining the origin to z naught. So this is your, this is your this is your path gamma. Now the straight line segment from 0 to z naught, where z naught is a point of the unit disk. What is the Euclidean distance? Euclidean length of gamma, of gamma, of gamma is going to be integral over gamma mod dz by 1 minus mod z the whole squared. This is the, this is the def, sorry, this is I should not put 1 by, should not put this, it's just mod dz. So what I'll get is, well, if I substitute for the expression for gamma, gamma of t, so z is gamma of t, so I will get t equal to 0 to r naught, and I will get here mod d, d of gamma of t, but gamma of t is t e per I theta naught, okay. And if I simplify this, I will get integral 0 to r naught, I have to differentiate this, I take the differential and the variable of integration is t, so I will get, I would differentiate this with respect to t, which will give me e power I theta naught, and then I will get dt, and then I will have to put a mod, and of course mod e power I theta naught is 1, so I will simply get integral dt from 0 to r0, and I am going to get r0, which is what I expect. The length of this straight line segment from 0 to z0 is r0, which is the Euclidean length, okay. Now let us calculate the hyperbolic length. What is the hyperbolic length? And of course I should tell you that of course r0 is strictly less than 1, because z0 is a point of the unit disk, r0 is strictly less than 1, alright. But what is the hyperbolic length of gamma? Hyperbolic length of gamma, well, it is integral over gamma mod tz by 1 minus mod z the whole square. So this is the formula for the hyperbolic length, okay. So if you calculate that, so you will get, what is that? So well, I will get integral from 0 to r0. So I again substitute this, I will get mod d d of t e power I theta naught by 1 minus mod t e power I theta naught the whole squared. This is what I will get. So I will get integral from 0 to r0. As usual, this is going to give me dt, right. So and the denominator I am going to just get 1 minus t squared, okay. And you know how to integrate this, you split it as partial fractions, you know it is 1 by 1 minus t minus 1 by 1 plus t, if I am not wrong. Maybe I should put a plus here. Let me, I will get 1 plus t plus 1 minus t, it is 2 by 1 minus t squared, so I will have to divide by 2. So this is what I will get, dt. And you know what this is going to give me, this is going to just give me, so this is half 1 by 1 minus t is log 1 minus t, so this is ln, if you want, ln, of course t is less, t is positive, so this is ln 1 minus t into minus 1, and here I am going to get plus ln of 1 plus t, and I am going to take limits from 0 to r0. So this is just ln 1 plus t by 1 minus t, alright. So I am going to get half ln 1 plus r0 by 1 minus r0. This is the hyperbolic length. So the hyperbolic length, the Euclidean length is r0, okay, which is the modulus of z0, whereas the hyperbolic length is, you have a fine funny expression, it is half ln 1 plus r0 by 1 minus r0. And now you can see something, the Euclidean length is finite, okay, it is bounded by 1. But you know, if z0 tends close to the border of the unit disk, okay, if z0 gets close to the boundary of the unit disk, then r0 gets close to 1, and as r0 gets close to 1, this approaches infinity, okay. I mean this denominator approaches 0, alright, and therefore this quantity approaches infinity, because r0 is going to tend to 1 from the left, okay. So this is going to approach 0 plus. So this quantity is going to approach infinity plus infinity, and ln of that is going to go to plus infinity. So the moral of the story is the hyperbolic length will tend to infinity as the point z0 moves to the edge of the unit disk, it, as it goes to the unit circle, okay. So you know, the so this is the beautiful fact about the hyperbolic length. The hyperbolic length makes this, in as far as the hyperbolic distance is concerned, this is not this is not a bounded thing. The unit disk is not bounded, okay. The disk, even the straight, even a segment, if you take straight line segment, if you compute a radial segment, its length tends to infinity in the hyperbolic distance. If the end point goes closer and closer to the unit circle, so this is the point about the hyperbolic metric. It makes the hyperbolic distance. It makes this in the sense of the hyperbolic distance. It makes the unit disk unbounded. Okay, so that's one fact that you have to notice. All right. So, well, now you know I have to. So I'll tell you that what is it that we need. Actually, we are looking for a statement like this. We are looking for a statement which says that if you take any analytic function from the unit disk to the unit disk, then if it is not an automorphism of the unit disk, then it acts like a contraction. Okay. So what I have defined. So you know, to define the notion of a contraction, I have to tell you what a metric is, because you know a contraction map is defined between metric spaces. It is defined from one metric space to another, and a mapping is said to be a contraction map if you know it decreases distances. You take two points in the source space, they have certain distance, but you take their images and then you measure the distance. The distance becomes smaller. So if this happens for a map, it's called a contraction map. And essentially the statement that I need for the proof of the Riemann mapping theorem is a statement that if you take a analytic map of unit disk to itself, which is not an automorphism, then it will necessarily be a contraction map. But contraction with respect to what metric? It is with respect to the hyperbolic metric which I am going to define now. Okay, what I have defined so far is just hyperbolic length of an arc in the unit disk. I am going to define the hyperbolic distance between two points in the unit disk. Okay, so let me do that next. So so hyperbolic metric, on the unit disk. So here is the definition of hyperbolic metric. So here is my unit disk. Okay. And of course, here also I should have marked this as 1. Here I should have marked it as 1 as well. This is the origin. This is the origin. All right. So, so you know, take two points in the in the unit disk. All right. Take two points in the unit disk, and what you do is the following: for z naught, z one, it delta, define the hyperbolic metric rho. So hyperbolic metric or hyperbolic distance function, the distance from z naught to z one, I'm using the symbol rho, okay, to be you know, maybe I'll use rho sub h to insist that this is hyperbolic. And you know what I do? I do the following thing. Simply join z from z0 to z1, you choose any path contour, comma, measure its hyperbolic length, and then minimize over all such possible paths. So the hyperbolic distance from z0 to z1 is the least of hyperbolic lengths of paths from z0 to z1, various paths from z0 to z1 inside the unit disk. You measure their hyperbolic lengths and then you take the minimum, you take the infimum in fact. Okay, so here is the definition. This is equal to infimum of hyperbolic length of paths from z0 to z1 in the unit disk. Okay, so this is the hyperbolic metric. So in other words, this is infimum over all gamma, such that the hyperbolic length is given by integral over gamma mod dz by 1 minus mod z the whole square. This is the hyperbolic metric, where of course gamma of such that gamma is a path in the unit disk from z0 to z1. So this is the hyperbolic length, okay. Okay, so you know, I am taking of course all lengths, all these integrals are non-negative, and you know, so this infimum does exist, right? But what is it, what is this infimum, and you know, does the infimum value, does it correspond to actually length of a particular path? That is the question. And the answer is yes, given any two. So here is the important statement about hyperbolic geometry. So given any two points in the unit disk, there is a special path from passing through, from this, between these two points, which is called a hyperbolic geodesic. It is the path of shortest hyperbolic length from between the two given points. And what is that path? The answer to that is that path is a circle passing through those two points, which is orthogonal to the unit circle. Okay, so that is a theorem. So the theorem is, so here is a very important theorem. The theorem is, for any two points z0 not equal to z1 in delta, the arc of the circle through z0 and z1 and orthogonal to the unit circle, okay, is the unique path of minimal hyperbolic length. From z0 to z1. So this is a theorem. So the theorem is that what is this hyperbolic distance? It gives you, see, the hyperbolic distance is defined by some minimization. It is the minimum. You are supposed to take all possible paths inside the unit disk from z0 to z1, measure their hyperbolic lengths, and take the minimum. Okay. Which seems a very it's not a definition that will help you to make calculations, because you have to find minimum. But the theorem makes it clearer. It tells you what is that path which will give you the minimum hyperbolic length. That path of minimum hyperbolic length is nothing but the arc of a circle passing through these two points, and which is orthogonal to the unit circle, namely, it is where it hits the unit circle, it will hit at 90 degrees. Okay, you know, two, you can also talk about the angle between two curves at a point, which at an intersecting point, it is by definition the angle between their tangents at that point. So we say two circles are orthogonal if they intersect say two points, and at each point of intersection the tangents to the two circles are perpendicular to each other. Right, so you know, so the picture is like this. You know, if I take the unit circle, if I take the unit disk, you know, if I take a point, if I take two points like this, okay, then you know, my hyperbolic geodesic it will be something like this. This will be the geodesic from here to here, and that's because this is the circle which passes through these two points, okay, and which hits the unit circle at 90 degrees. So you know, so this is z0, this is z1, and at this point if I draw the tangent to this circle and the unit circle, this will be 90 degrees. Similarly here, if I draw the tangent from here and here, this will be another 90 degrees. So this will be the hyperbolic path. And the beautiful thing is that, you know, if you draw all these hyperbolic paths of minimal hyperbolic lengths, which are called geodesics, you will get things like this. See, so you know, if you take two points along a diameter, okay, then the geodesic will be the diameter itself. Any diameter is a geodesic, because if you take two points, if you try to find a circle passing through two points which lie on a line, in principle there is no circle, but you think of it as a circle with you think of also straight lines as circles with the third point at infinity, okay. So the point is that the geodesics will look like this. You know, this will be one geodesic, any diameter will be a geodesic. Then you know, if you go a little to the left, the geodesics will become like this, and you know, if you get smaller, the geodesics will become smaller. This is how the geodesics will look like, okay. And the fact is that any diameter will be a geodesic, okay. And the theorem says that these are the paths of shortest length. That's how you get the paths of shortest length. So this is a theorem that we'll have to give a proof of, and we'll do that in the next lecture. So let me add here paths of shortest hyperbolic length are called geodesics for the hyperbolic metric. And so let me finish with one important statement. You see, if you are looking at the Euclidean distance, Euclidean metric, okay, then the geodesics are all straight lines, okay. If you take any two points in Euclidean space, what is the path of shortest length? It will just be the line segment joining those two paths, straight line segment. So the geodesics in the Euclidean metric, they are just straight lines, okay, all right. And straight lines are important for Euclidean geometry, right. In the same way, these geodesics that we get for the hyperbolic metric, okay, they will play the same role as straight lines play for Euclidean geometry, okay. So all the axioms, all the Euclid's axioms except the parallel axiom that hold for straight lines, I mean parallel axiom also holds for it's also taken for Euclidean geometry, but this, all those axioms will work with the geodesics for the hyperbolic metric, except that the parallel axiom you have to throw out the parallel axiom, okay. All other axioms that you have for straight lines, okay, the same axioms will hold good for the hyperbolic geodesics. So all these curves on the unit disk, they are the analogs of straight lines on the Euclidean plane. The analogs of the straight line on the Euclidean plane, which are important for Euclidean geometry, the analogs here are these curves, the hyperbolic geodesics. And you know, you can check a lot of statements, like, you know, if you take two lines, if they are not one and the same, and of course, you know, if they are not parallel, then they will intersect at one point in the finite plane. And of course, if you think of infinity as a point, then they will also intersect at infinity, all right. And in the same way, here also you can check that if you take two geodesics which are not one and the same, they will hit at one point, okay. And if you take three lines, you can use three lines to form a triangle, and every triangle is formed by three lines, okay, which are the lines passing through the lines, the sides of the triangle. In the same way, you can also define a hyperbolic triangle. A hyperbolic triangle will be something like this, you know. So if I draw a hyperbolic triangle, it will be like this. It's given by three hyperbolic geodesics. So one like this, one like this, and one like this. So this is a hyperbolic triangle, okay. And you know that in the Euclidean geometry, the sum of three angles of a triangle is equal to 180 degrees. What will happen in hyperbolic geometry is that the sum of the three angles of a hyperbolic triangle will be less than 180 degrees, okay. And so you will have all these nice things happening differently from what you know in Euclidean geometry. So hyperbolic geometry will give you new set of properties, okay. And the basis for all this is the so called hyperbolic length, which is defined for an arc. But the key to the fact that the hyperbolic length does not change under an automorphism of the unit disk is the equality in Pick's lemma, okay. So Pick's lemma, the equality in Pick's lemma is a beginning point for a whole geometry, okay. And now let me tell you, if you take this hyperbolic metric, then if you take any automorphism of from the unit disk to the unit disk, any automorphism from unit disk to the unit disk will be an isometry with respect to the hyperbolic metric, okay. That's what you will get, okay. So the whole beautiful point about Pick's lemma will be that, you know, any automorphism unit disk will actually be an isometry of the hyperbolic distance of the hyperbolic metric, and any map which is not an automorphism unit disk will be a contraction with respect to this hyperbolic metric, and that is a statement that we need to proceed with the proof of Riemann mapping theorem, okay, which we will do in the next lecture.